welcome once again to IGN's weekly PlayStation show. This is episode 836. I'm joined by my good friends Brian Altano, Travis Northup, and Akeem Lawanson. Beyond, hello everybody. I'm doing great so far.
How's it going? Porky Pig is in the house. How you doing, Max?
I'm doing okay. Brian and I had like a long running debate about whether or not Porky Pig is the host of Looney Tunes, which is like.
Of course he is. He says that's all. He's the one that ends the shows.
That's right. Brian's argument. You know? That's Brian's argument for that. And I don't know.
Yeah.
He doesn't do an opening though. And he doesn't show up doing interstitials. Well, he doesn't go up like that was Pepe Le Pew.
He's not Alfred Hitchcock. He doesn't have to do that. He just ends the show. That's it.
The opening is the logo. It's the Looney Tunes logo comes in, and then by the end he's at the end and he closes it. But he's also
just be the closer, right?
That's such a weird. Anyway, this is a show about PlayStation. There is stuff to talk about in relation to PlayStation. The big thing going on right now is that Xbox first party exclusive games are presumably going to be coming to other platforms. I want to talk about that in a second. There's also games that came out, which is very exciting. The last 2 weeks we had big old state of plays, which are always fun to get excited about. But it's also kind of nice to have some big old juicy games to sink our teeth into. Helldivers 2 is a big one right now. A lot of people are having a very good time with that. Travis, you're also playing Skull and Bones. Brian, you're actually playing Yakuza.
I am.
You know, like a dragon, if it wealth. I want to touch on all that stuff. But we should definitely talk about the Xbox thing. This was sort of a big, huge story last week. A lot of people got really worked up about it. I don't mean to chuckle at their despair or anything. Obviously, you know, there's a diehard Xbox community, and I understand the mentality of like, you know, you invest in this ecosystem under the assumption that there's a certain level of exclusivity to it. Like, you know, you get first party games on that platform only. That's why you're there. And then hearing rumblings that these first party games are going to trickle out elsewhere. There's a certain sense of, I don't know, buyer's remorse that comes with that.
Yeah.
The big buzz going around right now, there were some stories that are like still either unconfirmed or people are like, no, that was actually not accurate. But there's talk that maybe Starfield and Indiana Jones and the Great Circle will be coming to other platforms shortly after, I guess Starfield's already out, but like Indiana Jones would come to PlayStation presumably a few months after it hits Xbox. There's also talk of Sea of Thieves, which is, I feel like as far as these things go, not that surprising because it is like a big, you know, it's like a big online games as a service ecosystem type of thing. There's also Hifi Rush and Pentiment are apparently two that are coming to other platforms, which I get, you know, I feel like those were very critically acclaimed, but probably didn't really sell a ton of copies because they were both on Game Pass, and putting them out there for people to buy kind of makes sense. But we should talk about this because a lot of people are mad at Xbox for this. Phil Spencer said, "We're listening and we hear you. We've been planning a business update for next week." This was last week he said that, where we look forward to sharing more details with you about our vision for the future of Xbox. Stay tuned. This messaging is going to come by way of the official Xbox podcast in audio form. Tomorrow we'll have a full update about that, but it's not going to be presented as like an Xbox Direct being like, Xbox is now coming out for everything, Xbox for Switch, Xbox for PlayStation. I think it's going to be sort of a conversation about their business practices. Ryan, what do you think about this?
I understand why people are upset about this, because there are a lot of people that, like Max said, invested in the Xbox ecosystem, and with that comes I will say, like, the extremes are there's fanboyism, obviously, which is people who go into the, you know, the trenches of the console war. And I think that there's a thing there where they're like, I don't want anyone to have the thing we have, right? The thing that defines our box is these experiences. And if other people can have them, then I'm mad that I bought this thing, or I'm mad that they have them. There's emotion attached to it. Which is difficult because, like, video games have always been this weird intersection of art and business. You know, we've talked about that before. But Xbox's philosophy has been very overtly, like, we want people to play our games everywhere. Like, I think that, like, they will be the first moving away from the consoles. The idea of what a console is, and sort of like a screen is anything you want. Like, it doesn't make a lot of sense to me to be super worried about that just yet. I think the bigger implications are obviously, like, you know, in terms of ownership, like, we might lose the idea of, like, what it is to own a video game. That's a bigger conversation. I think everybody's sort of moving in that direction. What I think is fascinating is, and I tweeted about this, is that amidst all of this controversy, PlayStation launched Helldivers on PC. day and date as PS5, and it's their biggest launch in PC history. Destroyed all of the other games they've ever done. A lot of their game launches have been staggered. They've done some like sort of, you know, asymmetric multiplayer stuff where it launches on two platforms at once. But like, there's very clearly a business opportunity to extend your first party software to ecosystems outside of just the base console that it was built to play on, right? Now not every studio can do that because that's expensive. But I think it's like with the Xbox stuff, we got like a lot of hyperbole and a lot of emotions. People were saying like Gears of War is coming. And then yesterday it was like Pentiment and Hi-Fi Rush. And it's like, okay, well, you know, are we okay with that? Like, what is the issue here that we're losing something as an exclusive to a console? Is it that someone else is getting something? Like, is the problem sharing? Or is it the problem that Sony doesn't do any of this at all and neither does Nintendo, right? Sony and Nintendo are not interested in, especially Nintendo, is not even bothering with PC, right?
That's got to be some of it. I think there is that feeling of like, and this is, you know, this is sort of the root of a lot of kind of gatekeeping attitude, is like, you know, if you're with a thing through the hard times, you know, you want to sort of feel like you got to sort of chip on your shoulder when they're in the good times, you know, like,
yeah.
There's a, if you're the person who, you know, you sat patiently waiting for Xbox to put out some, you know, cool first party games. You're sitting there being like, well, you know, we're getting some third party stuff, but I really wish they'd get that, put out some games already. And like, you know, they're finally doing that. But then they're also like, but they're going to come to everything. And it's just like, well, what's the reward for, you know, standing by and being like a faithful supporter during the sort of the crappy parts?
No, totally. And like, yeah. I get that. I think it's difficult, right? Like I said, it's a business, and like by the accounts that we know, and Xbox hasn't reported on like actual hard data for console sales in a very long time, but we've heard reports that it's like being outsold by PS5 2-1, right? So in a situation like that, and you can obviously, you know, assume that the Switch is doing extremely well. Nintendo is, you know, has been consistently selling tens of millions of that system since what, 2017. Xbox has to do something, right? And this is where it makes me hypocritical, because when I turn on my Xbox, which I do constantly, I go to Game Pass and I'm like, what's here? And I'm not necessarily like, I don't really care who made it. It's the same way I treat Netflix, right? I'm not like, oh man, I haven't gotten a good Netflix original movie in a while. Like, I don't really give a shit what studio is making the movies on Netflix. I just want good new movies to be there. From no matter where they're from. My relationship with Game Pass is the same way. Whereas on PlayStation, like, I'm expecting more from their first parties. And I want these big, you know, narrative driven third person sad dad games, and I love them, and they come out every 5-6 years and they're great, and they revolutionize cinematic cutscenes and gameplay and action and scavenging or whatever. Like, they do all that stuff
slowly.
Do any of us remember what the temperature check was on the audience when we found out that Insomniac was going to put Spider-Man on PC? Like, what was the climate? Because, you know, this was a PlayStation exclusive for a while, and then, you know, it was announced that this was coming out on PC. I'm kind of curious what the audience was like. I feel like it was very similar to what
it was,
we're experiencing right now.
It was split in three distinct camps. One, there were people that were like, well, that's it. Why did I buy a PS5? Because it's going to look so much better, or a PS4, it's going to look so much better on PC. Two, people who were like, I'm really excited. And three, people who were like, I get to play this game as Waluigi. This is amazing.
Right, exactly.
Like, there were the bad, insane people like me that were like, oh, we're going to get the most craziest mods out of this. I'm not too precious about where the games go. But yeah, I think that like, there is, you know, the conversation around this is the fact that one company is willing to take these risks and put their games on multiple platforms. The other one, Sony, is sort of, you know, frequently dipping a toe in that pond, but like they still haven't, they'll do it with multiplayer, but I don't see them being like The Last of Us 3 is on PS5 and PC day and date, right? Because there's a theory there that like that would cannibalize console sales, right? But at the same time, Sony's also like, we're not putting our games on PS Plus day and date. So there, you have one company that's saying $70 games always and forever, first party launch, day and date on PS5, and then maybe get a later date on PC, a year or two later, or if it's multiplayer, everyone gets it at the same time. You have Nintendo being like, we do what we want. We don't care about any of you. Good luck out there. Have fun. And then you have Xbox being like, what are we even anymore? Like, are you, do you have a screen? Sure. You can play Pentiment there. And so it doesn't make a ton of sense, but I understand, I'm not going to call it desperation, but they need to do something to make money. And like the whole conversation about the Activision Blizzard acquisition was, hey, we're going to keep putting those games on PS5. That was the whole thing, right? Mm-hmm. Like they had to send emails to Herman Holst and whatever. And, you know, everybody was like, are you good? Are we cool? Can we do this? Like Call of Duty was like still going to come out. They had to make that deal in court and promise everybody and pinky swear the judge and all that shit.
It's a stupid business move to be like, okay, we're going to buy the most popular video game franchise in the world and then make a decision that makes it sell like half as many copies, a third as many copies. Like it doesn't make any sense, you know, like don't screw with that. And like, it's also like, this is the thing that Microsoft has demonstrated, you know, since they scooped up Mojang a million years ago, like Minecraft is still on everything. It sells more on Switch than it does anywhere else. Mm-hmm. Like, Travis, do you have any strong feelings about this? I feel like you're pretty platform agnostic about things.
Yeah, I'm extremely platform agnostic. I've said many times that I hate all of the platforms equally, but I love the games that they have. I just every platform annoys me. But I am actually somebody who plays mostly on Xbox because a lot of my friends tend to play, and I end up reviewing a lot of multiplayer games, and Xbox has a lot of those. And as somebody who plays a lot of Xbox, A, I kind of saw this coming, and B, I actually think it's a really good thing for Xbox players. And I think the people that are upset about it are probably short-sighted, or maybe they just haven't been in the loop too much. But this does a few things for Xbox. One, it lets more people play their games, and that's always a good thing for you, not just because you're making money, but because you're now saying to PlayStation people, hey, look, here's an Xbox game, and you're going to play it, and now you're going to maybe start having positive thoughts about Xbox and its brand, and you're going to see its logo on PlayStation. And they also still have a value proposition, which is, yeah, the games are on PlayStation and they're on PC, but they're $70 there. And on Xbox, they're on Game Pass. Yeah. And that is a very big thing to say, hey, here's all these great games you're playing on your PlayStation. And if you bought a $200 Series S, you could play them on Xbox for a subscription service. That is a major selling point to a lot of people. And the only way that PlayStation people figure out what they're missing out on is if they have a chance to play some of those games for $70. And so I actually think the Xbox console is really not in danger here, because Xbox will always need, at least as far as we can tell today, it will need a place to sell Game Pass. And if you have a subscription service, you don't remove the one platform where you can control that, right? Like you maybe would sell it on a TV as well, and people can get it on PC, but Xbox is it's basically your Game Pass box at a certain point.
It's the best place to play it. Like,
yeah,
exactly. You can play it on PC. You got to mess with your PC for that. You got to figure out your settings and all that. And then you could play it on like a, you know, X Cloud streaming thing, but that's not ideal. And like maybe your TV has it built in, and that feels like a completely like Wild West scenario. But like going to the store, you know, paying $300 to $500 to get a little box that you bring home and plug in your TV and it plays the games. That's like straightforward. That's cut and dry. That's, you know, that is the appeal of console gaming in a nutshell, which, you know, going back to the conversation about like, you know, people getting mad at Spider-Man coming to PC. I feel like PC is such a completely different beast from console that there's less of an issue. Like, no, people don't get as mad when things are on PC.
Yeah.
Because it's like, well,
it's almost a different market.
Yeah. It's like, is it even going to work on that particular person's PC? Who knows? Yeah. They might have to mess with it.
Right.
Yeah. The other arguments I think for this are that Xbox gets to do what they've been doing, which is kind of posture as the good guys on this issue in terms of like, hey, we want our games to be everywhere. I think that does a good for your PR and this argument that you're on the side of the player. And I think gatekeeping all of your games and trying to replicate PlayStation's walled garden, which historically hasn't worked for them, it would be a bad move. And if you're losing the game, which Xbox is by all accounts in last place in the console space, then you change the game to something that you have a better chance of winning. And I think that's what they're doing here. I think it's smart. The other argument for this is that Xbox makes a lot of online games and a lot of live service games. And we're starting to learn that those games die off pretty quickly if you don't make them available to everyone. And Xbox has actually been the victims of live service games not working out, probably because they have the smallest player base, right? And that makes it hard to make a live service games are already really hard to keep alive long term. And so if you're trying to do it on one platform, even Sony has realized that that is a problem, which is why Destiny, the new game that they own, is staying on all platforms, because it's really hard to manage those games. So I think there's a lot of reasons to do this. I suspect that it will be more than just the two games that were leaked. I think this is probably going to be a larger strategy, and I don't think it changes the value proposition for Xbox players of like, hey, yeah, it's on PlayStation, and you can play more games on PlayStation if all of the Xbox games are also on PlayStation, but right. you don't have to pay the full price for them on Xbox, and they're optimized for our platform and yada yada. I think there's a lot of advantages to that. Mm-hmm. Also, I like to think, you guys remember that episode of Game of Thrones where Tyrion is trying to figure out who the leak is, and so he tells a bunch of his different colleagues that he's going to marry someone like that. I feel like Xbox was testing to see how loyal their partners are and said, hey, we're gonna tell you that we're putting this game on PlayStation, and we're going to tell you that we're putting this game on PlayStation. And then they found out that all of their partners are traitors, you know, like all of the answers leaked out at once instead of just one or two.
No, it did. It brought a lot of that out. It brought a lot of fanboyism out. I mean, even on the PlayStation side, and I think if you're the biggest PlayStation fanboy in the world, and you know, there's a couple of you out there listening to the show, and like you refuse to play games anywhere else, you've never bought another console, you hate all the other ones, you hope they die or whatever. It is in your best interest to have Xbox remain as a competitive brand, because that is the best thing that can possibly happen to a consumer, is having a bunch of people vying for your time, your real estate, your money, all of that. You want all of that to work in your favor, because it puts a fire under people's asses, and these companies will work harder to make you better. And you want that. I also think that there was a lot of like, and this is like, you know, we're all, you know, like if you saw Usher play at the Super Bowl the other night and you recognize a bunch of the songs, like your body probably hurts in some spots when you wake up. We're getting older now. The reality here that I think a lot of us are like coping with, and have been sort of coping with on a microcosmic level for over a decade now, is that video games used to come in plastic boxes with paper rectangles that smelled good, and then you took them out and you put them inside of another box that was underneath your TV, and it played them perfectly, and that was it. That was your relationship with video games. You had a shelf, you had this collection, and like many other physical medias and many other ways in which we receive and send content, that's changing and has continued to change. And I think there's a lot of like, you know, sort of reticence to people not wanting to let go of what the idea of a video game and a console is. And like, we're going to get to a place where, like it or not, physical media will be like this thing that's just done in small collector circles. You have companies like Limited Run still doing awesome, awesome stuff, right? But the overwhelming amount of video games that get released now don't get physical editions. They just don't. Indie games come out every single day that don't get physical editions. The games that do get physical editions, you know, there's a Twitter account, I think it's called like Can I Run It or something like that. Correct me if I'm wrong. They document basically how much of the game is on the full disc at launch, right? And how much needs a huge patch. And, you know, that's a sort of hit or miss situation. There's a lot that ship perfectly, but there's also like, you know, you'll buy a console and it comes with like an empty Fortnite case or a code or something. There's the game, the day one patches, day zero patches, day negative two patches. We get early game codes sometimes that have 60 gigabyte patches before the game's even out. You know, like there was, I remember my our Steam Deck review done by Seth Macy. He was talking about how they were beaming him patches for that system 3-4 times a day for 3-4 weeks before the system even hit, you know, was available to pre-order and stuff like that. Like it's really crazy how much of a moving target that is now. And so I do think that there's like this unwillingness to let go of the reality that this is where games are moving. Now, is that entirely pro-consumer? I doubt it, because we're going to get to a spot. If you look at, what was it? Like Funimation just a week ago was just like, hey, sorry, your library's dead, right? Netflix, you wake up and they're like, oh, that movie we funded is gone. Disney Plus paid for an entire season of a Willow TV show, you know, like with the Kasdans and everything. And like, it cost $1 million and they got, you know, all the cast back, and then they just deleted it. It's just gone, and it doesn't exist on a disc. Like, that's a fear. Like, there's
the stuff I hate is things that only exist as subscriptions, you know, and this is, we haven't really seen this yet. I guess we currently are seeing this with Foam Stars. Foam Stars is only for PS Plus subscribers. You'll eventually be able to buy it, but like, and again, this is also a thing that requires it exists on the internet. Like, it's a multiplayer exclusive. That always felt like a kind of nebulous thing. When it's exclusively an online multiplayer game, if you have it by yourself, like, it, you know, if a tree falls in the forest, does it make a sound? Like, if you have it by yourself, but you can't play it with anybody, like, is it a game?
Alan Wake 2 cleaned up at the Game Awards last year, you know, industry darling, critical darling, I assume sold well, has not gotten a physical edition yet. Like, this is one of those things where it's like, yeah, it'll get there, but like, we're going on 6 months now, and then what, a year? Like, it's this used to be one of those things where it was like, you know, you would walk into a store and you would buy a game, and you would walk out, you'd go home, and it would work.
On that note, like, I you know, I'm glad that Alan Wake came out the way it did. Like, that came out on multiple platforms. That's awesome. Pentiment is a phenomenal game that will benefit so much by being on other platforms. I hope that game comes to Switch, because that is such a perfect Switch game, because it's basically structured like a book. Like, it's very much like, it's a lot of talking, it's a lot of reading, and it would be a wonderful thing to take with you on the go, and like, you know, stop, you know, put a bookmark in it, turn your Switch off, put it in your backpack or whatever.
Sell it to PlayStation fans, Max. How many, like, how depressed is the main character?
He's miserable. It's the olden days. Everyone's got like rickets, and they don't, you know, he's a manuscript illuminator and the rise of the Gutenberg printing press. It's a horrible time. Job security is nothing, but like, I love that game. And it's also like, it is not like, this is not the toppling of like the Xbox Microsoft Studios, like, first party library to have this like weird, wonderful, quaint little game get exposed to more people. Like, the fact if this game goes out in the world and like more people can see it, you know, like, that's good, that's great. Like, I remember, you know, this kind of reminds me of when there are phenomenal things, like phenomenal shows or movies that are on streaming platforms that nobody wants to bother with, you know. Like, I feel like was it Russian Doll, was that the one? No, that was the Netflix one, right?
That was the Netflix show. Yeah.
What was the one that was on Peacock or whatever?
Poker Face.
Yeah.
Yeah.
With Natasha Lyonne, which I watched a bunch of that, and then my Peacock subscription got up, and I was like, well, so much for that idea. But like, I don't know. I kind of miss the days where you could just like, you'd buy a season. Mm-hmm. Actually, I think I did that with Better Call Saul, because I didn't want to pay for like F-word AMC Plus. Like, I didn't want to deal with another thing. So I was just like, screw it, I'll just buy the season, and then I can own it.
Yeah.
And I'll only own season 6, which is a weird thing.
Yeah, I only got AMC Plus just to finish watching Better Call Saul. But same. I feel like one thing that, you know, we've talked about like the side of like the Xbox fanboys, but you know, and how they feel and like the different, you know, the different types of, you know, feelings and thoughts they might be having, but we haven't talked about like the PlayStation fanboys and how they feel about this. Do we think that we, or I'm saying we, but I'm talking about like I own all the consoles, but like the hardcore PlayStation fanboys who don't want to touch anything Xbox related. Do we think they're happy that they might be getting Hifi Rush or Pentiment or any of these games, or is it more so like, just keep that over there? If I wanted to experience that, I would ask my mama to buy it for me next Christmas.
I like that in your scenario here, PlayStation fanboys are children who only get consoles for Christmas. No,
that was a 30-something-year-old man that just asked for that. Are you kidding me? In my scenario,
his mom is really rich though, so she, you know,
that's true,
and she loves him.
Yeah, he's a nepo baby. The thing, I've seen a lot of like, cool, awesome, bring it our way. And there's a lot of smugness too, right? Like, because they're like, the empire is toppling. Like, this dynasty that's been around for so long. And I don't necessarily see that as the case either, right? Like, I think that there's been a lot of sort of like, kind of doomsday sky is falling. And that some of it's warranted, some of it's based on, you know, wild speculation and hearsay. But I would hope that if these games come to PlayStation, that PlayStation fans give them a shot. Like, I was making fun of PlayStation fans earlier that they only buy third-person sad dad games. But PlayStation fans buy a ton of weird indies and JRPGs and, like, shmups and all sorts of nonsense. Like, PlayStation has been defined by, like, this really wide library of really awesome games, many of which PlayStation themselves have stopped making. Like, I would argue that PlayStation's indie output has sort of decreased significantly since the PS4 or PS3 era. And so if they can get some weirder, quirkier, more interesting games their way, awesome. stuff like Halo and Gears of War, I'll believe it when I see it. I will say that there will be like a disconnect there when I like load up my PlayStation and I see a picture of Master Chief front and center, and it's not because he's in a Paramount Plus show.
I remember when I think it was Metal Gear. Was it Revengeance was the first one, or was it the HD collection? Whatever. Mm-hmm. Whenever they first put Metal Gear anything on Xbox, it felt weird. Like it was weird to hold that controller and play those games. And then like I remember like I think it was Final Fantasy 13 came to Xbox or 360, and that was like one of the first times a Final Fantasy was over there, and it was just there was something that felt. It felt strange. It felt unnatural. Like it wasn't. I'm like, this is a you can't. The X button's in the wrong place. You can't play this game like that. It doesn't work at all.
But I mean, I've been a Nintendo fan my whole life before anything else, and I've been on Nintendo voice chat here at IGN for years now. And like there, it was surreal getting Ori and Cuphead and games like that to start showing up on my Switch. It felt weird, you know, to see like the Microsoft Game Studios logos pop up at the beginning and stuff like that, because those were platform exclusive, console exclusive games that I associated with Xbox. And that's the thing. Like there's a lot of sort of tearing down the walls of what a console is, what owning a game is, and who makes what and where it's supposed to go. And like, I think we're going to see that change a lot. And I think, and you know, correct me if I'm wrong in a couple of years, but I think that this Helldiver situation is going to change. There's conversations happening at PlayStation right now, is my theory, about when and where games launch and how. Like, I think that PlayStation's going to start looking at their first party stuff and going, hey, like this is selling tremendously well. Last I read was equally across PS5 and PC, right? So you have a 50-50 split between those two platforms. That's huge. Again, multiplayer game, you want as many players as possible playing it, stress testing it and all that. That's great for that game. I have a feeling that this is going to kind of twist their arm a little bit, and they're going to get, may not be day and date for God of War 3 or whatever, or Spider-Man 4, but I do think like that window is going to start to constrict a little bit. And I think they're going to get a little more, they're going to test the waters a little bit more about getting those days closer and closer. Because there's you can get a lot of momentum, you can get a lot of sales. Steam is a massive, massive platform to sell games. And like, why give up on that money? When you read that, the last Spider-Man game cost $250 million, broke records, and there were talks about like how they didn't break even. There were leaks about potential layoffs in the studio. Like, if you can stop that from happening by getting money somewhere else, do it. Mm-hmm. Right? Do
it. Sell it.
Get money. Don't fire anybody.
No, I mean, I think this is the thing that like the upside to timed exclusives or for platform exclusives, and I this obviously works more with like third party stuff, but I think it's great when one of the big publishers scoops up something and obviously throws money at the people who are making this. And it's funny because this is a thing that was clearly happening with Bethesda prior to Xbox scooping them up. Like that's what happened with Deathloop and with Ghostwire Tokyo. Those were both PS5 and PC day one. They were coming to Xbox later, but very clearly I'm guessing Bethesda took a check from Sony to be like, yeah, well, or maybe it went the other way. I don't know, but either way, like, you know, it sucked for Microsoft players who wanted to get in on this stuff, but it also made it so the devs had to focus on one less platform. Like they were focusing on getting it running on these two platforms. And it also, whatever money they changed hands over that, it probably benefited the game in the long run. And like, you know, you see this with what, like Dave the Diver, is that's on Switch, that hit Switch first. Like I'm imagining. Yeah, I mean, it was on PC. It's always on PC first. Mm-hmm. Usually it's on PC first. It's actually weird when we see a console and PC day one. But like, you know, PC is always sort of seen as like a, you know, kind of a test bed for like a lot of indies, a lot of smaller games. But if there's a situation where, you know, a publisher can be like, hello, I have a dump truck full of money, I would like to play your hit new game. Like, you know, Pal World, for instance. Pal World, you know, got to be a Xbox exclusive day and date, which is, that's, I'm sure that didn't really need much help, but that undoubtedly helped, you know, line their pockets and, you know, line their coffers or whatever. And The only downside here is when you get something like, I don't know, like Towerfall, which was a Ouya exclusive. And, you know, when somebody gets locked into a sinking ship, like, and it's just like, well, it's timed exclusivity.
Stadia too.
Oh my God.
Yeah, no, Stadia. There were like a bunch of games that were really well received that they were stuck on Stadia, and I'm sure there was some, you know, god awful draconian paperwork that made it so they couldn't, like, well, Stadia doesn't work, can we just go on Xbox? They're like, I gotta wait a little bit longer. And I'm sure there's a bunch of stuff. At some point, we're going to see a wealth of really cool MetaQuest games dumped on PSVR too. We are seeing like a steady trickle, but I'm sure there's a bunch on there that were made, you know, they were timed exclusive with Meta money, and that helped fund their creation. But obviously, once they're funded and done, like, it's probably pretty nice to be like, hey, there's a whole audience here with another headset that we'd love to, you know, expose this to. You know, it's mm-hmm. it's less work to port a game than it is to make one from the ground up.
Still waiting for Half-Life Alyx, man.
Asgard's Wrath 2.
Yeah. Waiting for it. And that's, I mean, that's the, like, going back to sort of the history of weird exclusives, like, Brian, it was the Capcom 5, the GameCube lineup?
Yeah.
And it was, Resident Evil 4 was one of those.
Yeah, and the director of the game was like, if this goes to any other platforms, I'll cut off my head. And he has cut off his head 70 times since then.
Like, he's immortal.
They put it on iPhone. Like,
I mean, in that sense, like, the fact that, like, you know, he went and founded Tango Gameworks, which is the you know, studio that made Hi-Fi Rush. And I feel like there's a weird, very squiggly line between all these things, where had Bethesda not scooped up, I guess they founded Tango Gameworks to make Evil Within or whatever. That was always under that umbrella. I could absolutely see Hi-Fi Rush being a third party thing that very slowly went to other platforms. Like, that doesn't seem like an Xbox first party studio, if you know what I mean. Like, that doesn't seem like, you look at Hi-Fi Rush, and obviously it was a shadow drop thing on an Xbox Direct. This is the only place you can play it, you know, aside from PC or whatever. But, like, it completely fits to play a game like that on PlayStation or on Switch. Like, it seems organic. It seems natural. And it's, I don't know, like, I want to see more games get, you know, get played. Like, that's the goal, is for people to play games. That's the fun part. Mm-hmm. For, I feel like bickering back and forth about them being, you know, kept in their little walled gardens is like, it's gross and it's crappy and it's completely antithetical to both the people who make the games, the people who sell the games, and the people who play the games. Like, to be
it's dumb. This isn't a football team. It's not the 49ers versus, you know, Kansas City Chiefs. You know what I mean? Like, it's, you can play, you can own both consoles and you can enjoy the games that come out on either or. So to be upset that a game is being ported over to another console is ridiculous to me. I never understood, you know, that space on X or the Twitter space where people are arguing about that type of stuff. It always just boggled my mind when people, you know, would, like, either call any of us, like, because we're talking about a game, you know, in very positively on this podcast, like, oh, you're a Sony pony boy, or mm-hmm. IGN is a Sony, they're being funded by Sony just because we're talking about a game positively. It's just ridiculous to me. Like, there shouldn't be any sort of, like, sides where it's like one against the other. Games are made to have fun. Let's just have fun.
Okay, so I want to try something before we actually talk about some of the fun games we've been playing. If the roles were reversed here, like if the you know, the Xbox situation was happening with Sony, and there was rumblings about Sony first party stuff winding up on Xbox or Nintendo, what games would we share? Like, what are the ones that make sense to go elsewhere? Like, what is, you know, there's some that have, you know, we've been seeing stuff, you know, go over to PC or whatever. But I think it is kind of fun to think about this, because there's a level of like discomfort where you're like, that doesn't feel right. That's a PlayStation game. That shouldn't go over there. But I want to kind of see, like, if we had to share some of our toys, which ones would we share?
I mean, I want to see The Last of Us Part II running on Switch for utterly selfish reasons, just because I feel like it wouldn't even render Joel's beard properly. Like, it was, what was the,
so you want to, like,
Mortal Kombat?
Or whatever.
Oh, yeah, it was Mortal Kombat. Yeah, one. Yeah,
with the Johnny Cage cutscene where he takes off his glasses and he's just like, his eyes get all bucked out.
He has a wonky eye. Yeah.
Okay, that, so that's one reason to want to share.
Spider-Man.
I was gonna say Spider-Man Miles Morales. It's a short and sweet game. Just mm-hmm. to like let that audience experience like what these types of games can be. Potentially, maybe it'll you know. But I guess, like, what will incentivize them to want to purchase a PS5, I guess, is because, like, we don't have something similar to Game Pass, really, with all the benefits that Game Pass provides.
You're overthinking it. I'm just thinking, like, if we had to share these games, we don't need to go on the business side.
I'm sorry. I was in the mind of a businessman.
No, it's okay.
The one wearing the suit. That's Travis.
Be in the mind of a Spider-Man.
Of a Spider-Man. Yeah, I think that'd be the perfect game, right? Like, it's a nice short introduction to the Spider-Man universe. I think it's fitting.
That's an interesting way to approach it, to sort of be like, you get one of them, you get like a little tease. You don't get all of them, but you get one. And then if you want the rest, you got to come over to go to the dealer's house or whatever. Spider-Man to me was like this. I actually kind of hate the weird exclusivity situation that Sony has with Spider-Man, because like in the same way that, you know, they've got this, like, you know, Spider-Man is as good as it is because it is specifically taking advantage of the PlayStation, which is like, that is one of the reasons it is so cool and so solid. But also, like, Spider-Man belongs to everybody, you know, like Spider-Man,
household name. Yeah.
Spider-Man got his start because it's a comic book, which is like the most accessible media possible. Like it costs $2. You don't need to have a specific piece of hardware to read it. You don't even need to be able to read it. You just look at the pictures. And like, for that to go, you know, from like, how to enjoy Spider-Man, from that to like, you need to buy one specific $500 machine. And like, you know, obviously that's video games in general, but like there was a stretch there, and you know, in defense of Sony, these weren't good Spider-Man games, but there was a stretch there where Spider-Man was multi-platform when Activision had the license. Yeah. I just feel like this is a character that, you know, is so beloved all over the place. It would be nice if everyone got to, you know, play these wonderful games, but there are also, you know, there's strong arguments for it to not be on every platform.
No, obviously, you know, like they're helping to fund it and stuff like that. And they own the character. So it makes sense. They had the same font during the PS3. But like it's like saying, you know, Spider-Man No Way Home is exclusive to AMC or Regal Cinemas or something. Like, it doesn't make a ton of sense. These are, like you said, this is a character that belongs to everybody. It would be cool if it could go everywhere. I understand why it doesn't. You know, Spider-Man hat off, businessman hat on. Like, I get it. I totally get it. But yeah, this is the game that, like, the most people would appreciate. This is the, you know, it's, I'm not gonna, I can we call it a casual game? Like, it's, you know, there's hardcore arcade action platinum trophy elements to it, but like, also you can go in this game and hold R1 and just swing forever, and then hit mash the buttons and beat people up. Like, this is a game that kids can love, that adults can love, that it would be awesome if you could play it everywhere, right? I understand why it won't happen. Sony's not really interested in doing that. Makes sense. They'll put it on PC. But yeah, it'd be cool to see it everywhere, especially Switch. Because look how, how bad would this city look? It would look like Lego City Undercover. It would be amazing. Spider-Man wouldn't even have a mask. He would just look like a mannequin. It would be incredible.
I like your reasoning there. Travis, what about you? Is there if we have to take anything from the PlayStation stables and farm it out?
Yeah, well, first, I think, you know, for these sorts of games that are single player, and they'll probably keep their walled garden up, so I don't think they'll do that. But I think there are some games that they're going to have to do it if their live service ambitions still hold true with all those live service games they want to make. I don't think you can really afford to skip over all the other platforms, especially PC. Xbox is in a much smaller position. So I don't think their positions are equal. Like, I don't think PlayStation has the same incentive to go multi-platform because they have one of the larger
installment bases.
That's actually why they do such a better job at acquiring third party exclusivity, is because you don't have to pay somebody all that much to skip Xbox because of their low user base. But if Xbox tries to do the same thing with PlayStation, it becomes exorbitantly expensive. So I don't think they will do it. But I don't think they'll do it for single player. But if they had to do one, I would probably pick Returnal. And my reason for that is because I like that game and wouldn't mind playing it again. But also, the PlayStation version has that weird thing where the triggers do two things at half and full presses. And I would really love to make that go away on the Xbox controller. So, that would be one where, just for my, controlling preferences.
Has like my favorite use of the DualSense.
That's the reason you want to, like, I'd love to get some PS5 games on Xbox, because I hate those haptics. Just make them.
If you do a half press, it shoots the gun. And if you do a full press, it shoots like a bomb. And I killed myself with a bomb so many times, because during like really difficult parts of that game, you know, you kind of don't have I'm gripping my controller hard and doing full presses on accident. And so, selfishly, I would just, I would like it on the Xbox controller so that I don't have to.
You would like
that.
PlayStation games to go to other platforms so they have less features. Is that what you're saying? You want less haptics?
Exactly. That's right. Yeah,
audio is too spatial. Make it yeah. mono.
Yeah. The other thing of the controller talking to you sometimes always freaks me out. You know, and it's like, yeah, take that away too.
That's fair. That's a good segue right there. Now, speaking of PlayStation exclusive games where you can blow yourself up with bombs a whole bunch, Helldivers 2 is out right now. A few of us have been playing it. A few of us are getting our feet wet. Travis, I think you have been really getting in the shit out there. What's your take on this game?
Yeah, so I've gotten to see this game a couple times. I played it last month before it was out at the Sony studio, which was a lot of fun. So I've seen some of kind of the end game play where all the stratagems are unlocked and you're playing on the highest difficulty 9, which is insane. And then obviously now that the game's out, I've seen some of the earlier game stuff. And it's just a ton of fun, man. It's one of those games that just is unabashedly a video game. It doesn't really try with story. It's just fun hopping in with your friends and accidentally killing each other, and nobody's mad, everybody's laughing, and it's a lot of fun. I love the gadgets. I love the Starship Troopers vibe and the satirical Super Earth setting. And honestly, the transition from top down to third person is done so well. Sometimes I'm playing this game and I forget that Helldivers 1 wasn't like this. You know, it's just like, this is kind of all I know now. And it's really good. It's also super challenging. I'm sure nobody here has gotten to try the difficulty level 9 just yet, but somebody who tried that and just got absolutely blown apart in the preview, this game can legit get challenging too. So I'm really excited for people to get into higher tiers and start taking on some of that, because I assume by that point it will no longer be funny if your friend accidentally kills you. It'll be probably a lot sweatier and intense, and I kind of want to see what how the community reacts to that level of play, because right now I feel like it's all fun and games since we're killing these squishy bugs, but when you start seeing 900 Terminator robots with chainsaw arms rushing at you, it's going to be a pretty different game, I think. But it's a lot of fun.
This is a game that definitely was meant to be played with friends or randos online, because, you know, I jumped into this over the weekend just to give it a shot. And yeah, I was playing solo. You know, I was playing at odd hours in the morning, and I was overwhelmed with just like the hordes that were coming at me. And I was like, is this how this game's supposed to be? You know, because I mean, like, I'm new to the Helldivers universe. I've never played. I didn't play the first one, so I wasn't too familiar with it. What I was getting myself into, but like, you know, like you said, Travis, I feel like playing this alone solo, it was fun, but again, just very challenging because I have to keep running around and dodging the hordes as they're coming at me because I have no backup. But I feel like playing this with friends, it'll just heighten it even more. And you said you were playing. Were you playing with like who are you playing with? You playing with the Kind of Funny people?
Yeah, so at the preview event, it was Greg Miller and Andy and the Kind of Funny team. But I've been playing with randoms and some of the people I know. Since it's got crossplay, thankfully, I can reach into PC and PlayStation friends. Mm-hmm. This is my footage here, actually. That's me getting killed on level 9 difficulty, in case you're wondering.
That's
what
just
that
a
looks
blur
like.
Of lasers.
It is very brutal. I would say this is 100% a game you should play in multiplayer. It really feel I've also played single player as well, not intentionally, but because the matchmaking has kind of been busted in these early launch days, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. Although that seemed like it maybe got fixed last night. We got a patch, and I haven't had issues since. The thing about this game is the idea is, what if you were an extra in an action movie, right? You know, in an action movie where the hero's running through and killing like 100 aliens, and then in the background you see like one guy getting killed by like the smallest bug out there, and you're like, what the heck? The goal is you and your friends are those extras. And so you're intentionally really squishy. You're overwhelmed by lots of enemies. You die really easily, and that you're, you know, outnumbered and outmatched. And that's kind of the fun in it, is can you survive and kind of fumble your way through, and when you get killed, you canonically die, and then somebody else just comes in to fill your role, and so that that kind of like, you know, you're just meat to be grinded by this war machine and, you know, this fascist
extremely extremely faithful Starship Troopers game with everything 100%. But the license, like, and I feel like there's a long history of video games taking an idea from an existing piece of media and like, you know, not not paying, you know, just changing their homework enough so they don't get in trouble or whatever. But like, this is such a, like a clear labor of love to the, you know, the Paul Verhoeven movie, not the Heinlein book, like the silliness of the movie. And it's just, the squishiness of the bugs is like spot on. I don't really remember the first game having that much of a, feeling like that much of an homage. Like obviously it has similar themes. Like you're, you know, you are literal starship troopers and you're going to go fight bugs and all that. This one feels like they're really leaning into that really heavily. And it is completely inoffensive. Like it's charming. It's, they do such a good job of it. And it really just, like you're talking about sort of, you know, there being there, there's a deep ocean of difficulty there. Like if you want like a real challenge, it's there, but it is such a fun game to just jump into with some friends and just like get your ass kicked and laugh it off. Like it's just really, it's very easy to pick up, very easy to figure out. The tutorial is extremely funny. I just kind of jumped in and played with some like, you know, random person online for a second. And I was like, I don't know what wasn't grabbing me about this prior to launch based on what we'd, you know, seen. I think it looked a little, I don't know, generic is the wrong word. It looked like a video game, which is fine.
Yeah.
Actually getting my hands on it, there's something that is so much, when you're playing it, it is so much less serious than it looks, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, it looks like Gears of War, but plays by Earth Defense Force, right?
There it is. Nailed it.
I like that. Yeah.
Spot on. Yeah.
Yeah, and I love Earth Defense Force. I'm one of those guys. I reviewed that back in the day, and even with all the terrible performance and voice acting, I was like, this game's great. Like, you know, this game is awesome. And so this just really reminds me of that with a higher budget and more polish. You do lose some of the jank, unfortunately, but I think it just works really well. My one concern with this game, and I guess we'll see if this materializes, is that, you know, after playing it a couple hours, once you've played kind of the high-end content and you've redone it, My concern is that as a live service game or as an ongoing multiplayer game, that it's not going to have a ton of runway. And that's just because right now there's only two enemy factions. There's, you know, a couple weapons to grind for and that sort of thing. But once you've played a couple objectives multiple times, you sort of have seen all that there is. And then it's just about kind of grinding it until you get through the season passes and whatnot. And in interviewing the devs, they're live service answer for me was basically like, we have some kind of outlines in the work, but we're kind of going to wait for the community feedback and build from there, which is a great answer from a community perspective. But historically, as a guy who covers a lot of live service games, it's not a great answer for a live service game perspective, just because, you know, the ones that we've seen succeed have had to have multiple seasons mapped out and already worked on before the game comes out. And it doesn't seem like we have that here. So I'm a little worried that, you know, people will get burned out, and that we won't get new content for quite some time. But I could be wrong. The Helldivers 1 had three factions in it, and I think we're probably going to get one of those. I don't know how long that would take, but that would be my guess. And, you know, maybe they've got more surprises waiting for us. But for now, I'm really loving the community's reaction, and I'm having a ton of fun playing it.
I'm
probably going to do so right after this call.
Yeah. One of my main questions, though, I want, maybe y'all can answer this for me. How many franchises have made a successful transition from over the top to third person action?
I mean, this is the thing you don't see as much anymore. Like
Zelda. The big
one, I mean, Grand Theft Auto, right?
Zelda, yeah, GTA, Fallout. Zelda,
and look how long that's been around, you know? So, I mean, I have a lot. I'm just saying that because, like, I have a lot of faith in just, like, the Helldivers franchise. Because, like, I mean, like, honestly, this is my first introduction to it. And Zelda is another one. Yeah, like you all said. Like,
calling it a franchise is generous. You know, it's like their second game in years, I think.
I have a lot of faith in them. That's all I'm saying. I mean, look how long we've been playing GTA Online. I mean, give me a break, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, I mean, the idea of like a bigger budget Earth Defense Force is awesome. Like, it's really cool. And it was also just like, you know, I'm really excited to start playing this game. I have it installed and ready to go. As like a, you know, a big schlocky sci-fi fan that loves dumb like this in movies, like the idea of this becoming a really popular franchise for years to come is amazing. That rules. Like, this is the kind of stuff that attracted me to video games to begin with, right? Like, you would go in an arcade and there would just be like some dumb game called like Bug Zone, and like, you know, there'd be like you know, plastic guns that you could shoot all the bad guys with and stuff like that. Like, I love just like video, like Travis, like you said, video game ass video games, just like a, you know, unabashedly, like, this is a video game, it's not really about a big story. It's not really about like bringing in AAA voice actors and, you know, Hollywood scripts and all this stuff like that. Like sometimes like you just have a rough week and you want to sit down and you want to blow up some huge disgusting creatures, and that's great. I encourage the hell out of that. This is not like, you know, a big AAA franchise, but like if this turns into a thing that like we get, you know, more content for this and more sequels and stuff like that for years to come, that rules. I love that so much.
I guess I'm just skeptical of like the arcade thing is a perfect comparison. Like it is a very arcadey game. Like the first one was very, you know, it felt like buddying up with your friends and just, you know, crowding around in like a arcade cabinet, even if you were playing online or whatever. And this one, I don't know. Like I don't want the live service thing. Like I want to have a good time with this. I want to sink a bunch of hours into it and, you know, have a good arcadey experience. But like I wasn't even thinking about the sort of long tail of it. And I'm, you know, it's not my job to figure out what they're going to put in there, but I am skeptical of them managing to sort of, you know, meet those demands. Like, I think they were like coming soon, yeah. The mech. And I'm like, don't make me wait for a mech, but also I'll wait around for a mech. That's a,
yeah. You love Gundam. Come on. Yeah.
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 Oh, it's going to be a sick mech.
You have to do something to keep it alive. And I think, you know, looking at the menus, that's another kind of criticism I've got of this game is the menu system and all the different, there's like two separate season passes you're progressing through and stuff like that, I think is a little convoluted. And so I think they just have some work to do on the seasonal model, but I mean, they've got a great foundation to work from and people are having fun. Shout out to the absurd, intentionally obtuse mini games you have to play anytime you interact with a console terminal in this game, you know, where you have to like enter up, down, left, right.
A cheat code essentially.
And,
yeah.
Yeah. You have to solve little mini puzzles and they just make it intentionally obtuse. Some of them have like 8 steps, you know, where you have to go through like all these little mini games just to make one thing happen. And
that's a thing from the first one that I completely forgot about that I like immediately said, oh, this is great. It's so dumb too. Like, I just love it. It doesn't pretend to be like, you know, it doesn't try to be some like sci-fi looking mini game. It's like, nah, do a button code.
Do a code. And then they the great thing about being in the third person perspective versus top down is now you get to see them just like haphazardly jamming their fingers like Neanderthals into the terminal. I love that animation so much. It makes me laugh every time.
It's slapstick too. Like the first time I died was from like I stepped on a spore pod and it just like catapulted me to the side and I was like, it's like you died because of impact or whatever. And I was like, what is this? I want to get killed by bugs. Like, what is this?
My favorite death so far is I saw a teammate the ship that's supposed to evacuate landed right on top of him. And he died that glorious death. I mean, the things that can kill you in this game are very funny.
That's the charm of it. It's just it is as brutally like disrespectful of human life as the Starship Troopers is. Like you're like, this is funny. This is we're messed up people. We're horrible, but it's pretty cool. And the bugs eat the guy or whatever, and just rip him in half. It's, you know, gets killed by a spaceship door opening or whatever. Now, Travis, real quick, I want to touch on Sea of Thieves, a game that we've been
Skull and Bones.
Skull and Bones, Sea of Thieves.
I can talk about Sea of Thieves too, slip. If you want.
Coming soon to PlayStation.
The hottest new topical Xbox game coming. No. Yeah. I can.
Max,
can
I've been saying Sea of Thieves instead of Skull and Bones for what, 14 years now? How long has that game? Like, as long as both of those games have been known quantities in some capacity, I've been.
They were announced around the same time, if I'm not mistaken, and Skull and Bones is only just getting around to coming out now, which is kind of hilarious.
In the time that Sea of Thieves took to go from like, oh, people don't like this, it's not gonna, and then they built a whole community, and it was like the game that redeemed itself the most of the Game Awards, and then they're like, anyway, we're working on our next project now, and Skull and Bones is like, we're doing open beta,
we're still doing
it's
it,
finally
too.
Out,
yeah.
So how is it?
First, I think you got to mention the history here, as you guys talked about. Like, when this game was first revealed, it was a 5v5 multiplayer only, you know, like basically For Honor with boats. It was kind of that same type of game. And then we heard that it was completely different. It was going to be open world and it was going to have a story and there was going to be land combat. And then we heard that changed and it was going to be purely ship combat and an open world ship game. And that is what they landed on. So I've now seen this game in like 5 different iterations. I previewed it a bunch of times. And even in the past couple months, they've made big, big changes to the game. Like, for example, in the first beta, in the tutorial, you meet like this pirate captain and he's like dying and he basically passes you the baton and says, hey, go be a great pirate. And it kind of introduces you to the world. And in the final version, they just made that guy fully dead when you meet him for the first time. And they're just like, oh, you just take the map from his corpse and then you go off to go be a pirate legend. So they've really, really not been afraid to just like completely, you know, throw the baby out with the bathwater and try over. And I
is that what that is? Bathwater all over this game?
Yeah, this is it's a giant bath. But yeah, let's talk about the final product, which is, you know, I played 30 hours during the open beta this past weekend, which has pretty much all the content. It was like surprisingly ungated. There were certain things you couldn't do, but you could get really far, uncover the whole map, do all most of the activities, and I spent a ton of time in it, and it's actually a lot better than I thought it was going to be. I mean, the story is pretty much a nothing burger. It's basically, hey, go and be the best there ever was type of pirate journey. The combat is awesome. It's weirdly like an RPG. It's got all these different classes you can see here on screen where you can build like into DPS or tank or a support role where you're healing other ships by shooting cannons at them. And you know, you're working with other ships to take down larger fleets or uber powerful enemies or giant sea creatures. They've got some sea creature boss battles in there that are really cool. And so they give you a ton of stuff to do. And it is weirdly addicting. Like, you know, it's, oh, if I can just craft this one cannon type, then my ship will be awesome. And then you find out, oh, well, to craft it, I've got to sail to this new area and I've got to fight this new faction of sailors that are more powerful. And you know, so you're constantly kind of exploring and grinding and working on your build and finding new and interesting stuff to do. And so I think it succeeds at the main thing it really has to succeed at, which is the ship combat has to be great. It has to be complicated. There has to be lots of different types of ships that you can build that do different interesting things. And it does that really well. Of course, the question for anybody who's kind of got a big question mark on this game, which is probably most people given that it was announced 10 years ago, which is that what does it not have, right? This is the captain who's dead, by the way. He's not alive in the current version. So you're getting a sneak preview at content that no longer exists. But there he is. Yeah. That's what he looks like now.
When you oh, wow. So you walk in on him with knives in his belly. He's just dead.
He's just fully dead in the current version. And the version.
That's how I feel about a lot of introductory cutscenes. Just kill him.
Yeah. So I think that might've been the feedback they received is too much story, bro. Get me in the cannons. They took that note, I guess. The big question is what are the things that this game isn't, right? And it's not really a game you play for story. Here's another example of a change, by the way. They just deleted a character, which is a really weird choice in the final version. They just replaced it with a different character. What is this game isn't? It's not a game with story. It's not a game where you do anything on land like Assassin's Creed Black Flag, which a lot of people compare it to since it was inspired by that game and at one point maybe even a spinoff to that game, according to credible reporting. And so there's just a lot of questions about that. Is do you want to play a game where you essentially are a boat and you float around and do stuff? This game is closer to Forza Horizon than it is to Assassin's Creed Black Flag. I mean,
that is the first thing you've said about, I've heard about this game that makes me like actually.
Yeah, same. I put like 150 hours in that game.
Yeah. So it is basically, you know how they call it a car-PG? You're playing as a car and you're doing an RPG. I would call this a CRPG, where instead of C, it's SEARPG. Mm-hmm. It's
what
basically
about
that.
RPG.
Right? There you go.
Yeah, but see, that implies that you're going to have like swashbuckling, which is not part of the game.
Right.
So, yeah, I really want everybody to know that this is a game where it is just you are essentially controlling a boat at all times. The only time you're playing as a pirate is when you're in social spaces, walking around, talking to vendors, talking to NPCs, but you do not do any combat or really even any treasure hunting. There's like some areas where you can like dig with a shovel, but it's not Sea of Thieves. It is more akin to a Forza Horizon game where you're just going around the map and you're exploring and you're upgrading and finding new stuff and of course fighting ships, and the ship to ship combat is awesome.
So the areas where you can dig with a shovel, like what are you digging for? Is it treasure or
Yeah, it's treasure and loot and items. It's usually to complete a quest, because a lot of quests are like, hey, travel to this faraway place and go find this thing. But it's not like you're going to an island where, you know, a skeleton might attack you in Sea of Thieves. It's like you're going to a social space where there's just other NPCs standing around that you can talk to or trade with. And then near them, there'll be like a small patch of dirt. It's you're never, ever doing any exploration on foot, really, except for when you're in a town or a village.
Why? Like that's that. Really odd. I understand there being like social spaces, you know, do that whole kind of like, you know, Destiny hub type of thing.
Yeah.
But to have you like go dig like a little bit, just like a little shovel.
Yeah, they just barely dip their toe into it. And so I think it's probably a remnant of an old idea that no longer is a part of the game, because we know that at some point there was going to be more leg gameplay, you know, where you're walking around doing stuff. That got cut at some point, but you can see remnants of it in the game. You cannot. Literally the only time you're ever walking around is you're just going to a vendor to like craft something or have a cutscene conversation with somebody.
But how far into the water can you walk? Can you walk like to the shore? Can you get your ankles wet?
You can walk on the beach and go near your little boat and then click Y to go back to your boat. But like all the gameplay, all the gameplay happens on the ship. You are effectively controlling a ship at all times.
Can you do stuff on the ship besides like, can you go fishing? Like, is there a sense of like,
Yes. So interestingly, like, for example, you need to gather materials, right? And so you got to hack down trees if you need like wood for your ship, lumber or whatever. When you do that, you'll see a little prompt while you're sailing by the shore, and it'll say harvest that material. And then when you click it, it does a little mini game where you like have to time it, and you're basically sawing it from the ship. But it's basically like the ship is holding out a saw on the side of its port and just, you know, sawing the tree down. Basically, you're doing it as I'm telling you, you're doing everything as a boat. It's weird.
Brian and I interviewed Suda51, the No More Heroes guy, a while ago.
Yeah,
we asked him to like pitch a Batman game, and I can't remember if this was before or after Arkham Knight, but his pitch,
it was before. Yeah,
was it before? He pitched a Batman before. Game where Batman doesn't ever get out of the Batmobile. Like, he just does all his stuff while he's like, just, he just, I don't know if he's, you know.
Yeah. So this is that game.
It's that with pirates.
This is that game, but with pirates. It's what if you were just the boat part of the fantasy? Now, I will say this, like, as soon as you wrap your mind around what it is and what it isn't, which a lot of people aren't going to be able to get past that. And I don't blame them, because it's not the game some people want to play, which is fine. But once you get past that and you accept that it is just a CRPG, right, in the same way that Forza Horizon is a CARPG, that is a ton of fun to just play in. And it also does some things that are like types of pirate games we don't have, which is it has a whole economy system where you're building trade routes and you are managing a black market and you're taking over forts and then taking their supplies to different ports where it is worth more. And so it has kind of like this almost I don't want to call it like a real-time strategy, but like kind of like a Civ game where like the trades and the economy matters, and you're trying to like, it's like an economics type game. It has an economy to it. And so it appeals to the exact type of player that doesn't probably want to, you know, it has almost no overlap with like the Black Flag crowd, really, except for the ship combat. And I think that's why people are so confused, is what this was originally billed at and what the rumors have been, and the fact that you see your pirate walking around, people are like, oh, that must mean it's going to have, you know, sword combat. Nope. Mm-hmm. Doesn't have any of that, man. It is literally just a game where you play as a boat.
Wow. It's yeah. What I
I mean, wow, you just took the winds out of my sails. I mean, I was so excited for this game, just because, like, I mean, the only pirate-esque games I've played were One Piece Odyssey, like the One Piece games. So I was so excited to actually like live and breathe like the whole pirate universe, like on the ship and, you know, off, like searching for treasure. And the fact that that's not like a part of, that's not an aspect of this game or a feature of this game, I don't know. I'm no longer excited for this.
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah. So if you really like the whole pirate fantasy,
yeah,
this is not going to scratch that itch. But if you like Forza Horizon and that sort of idea, but with pirate ships, you're probably going to love it, because that's basically that.
I mean, that made me care a little bit, but I'm also just completely baffled that that's the comparison you make. Like, that's, it makes sense. It's sound,
Yeah.
But also, guess, man, what a bizarre journey it's been to this game actually being out.
My thing is, like, Forza Horizon is it's very silly at times. You know, like you could get the mystery machine from Scooby-Doo and like go off the biggest jump in the game and like there's
can I make my pirate ship say Pornhub on the side of it?
Oh yeah, what's the customization like on the ships?
Yeah, you can make it say Pirate Hub. it's pretty good, and that's actually one of the parts we haven't seen. Well, I say we because the game came out I think while we were on stream. I need to go and play the full version right now, but we haven't seen the full customization, but everything about like, if your question is the part relating it all to boats, is it good? The answer is yes. Like they laser focused on that. So like cosmetics are great. Build crafting is great. Combat is great. Like the way that they control and the way that they fire, and you can get mortars that like shoot up in the air and then drop from the sky. So you like are moving a little reticle around the ocean, and basically it's like calling in an airstrike in Helldivers, right? You can do a support build where you're shooting people with shotguns that heal them, and you can get a flamethrower on the front of your ship that just shoots cool. Like, and then later you can upgrade it so that it's like a blue demonic fire through a quest line that requires you to get like a demon head. And like all of the ship questions are like, yes, it's fun. It's silly. It's over the top. It's well thought out. It's great for co-op. It's just really the question of like everyone's expectations of this is not that at all. And that's the hardest thing that they're going to have to overcome, because I just don't think people understand what this game is.
And Travis, maybe you can answer this definitively. I think answers are online, but like as far as like raiding other ships, like boarding other ships and fighting other pirates on the other ships, you can't do that, can you?
So here's me with my flamethrower, by the way, that I got to experience in the endgame preview. You can board other ships, but when you do it, it goes to a cutscene where your crew members go off and then you just win the fight, right? So if you get basically getting boarded is a lose state in the game. Like if you let somebody, that's how ships get destroyed. And the other thing about this game that is kind of surprising is there is almost no PvP. It is a co-op game. It is a game where you the only ships you fight are NPCs.
What?
There is one exception to that, which is there are certain activities where it's basically like, hey, there's this boat on the map that has a bunch of loot and everybody has to go and try killing it. And when you kill it, you get to take treasure from it. While you're fighting that ship, nobody can attack each other. You could shoot cannons at them, but they don't do any damage to fellow players at any point in the game. However, in that one activity, when whoever picks up the treasure suddenly becomes hostile, like other players can attack you and they can try to take that treasure. And so it's kind of like a little mini game where every once in a while there's a really valuable ship on the map. You have to go there and kill it, presumably with other ships helping you. But then whoever picks up that gold, all of a sudden all hell breaks loose. Everybody's trying to kill that guy and take the treasure. And so there's like one specific activity. My guess is PvP will be added in some form, or there'll be like a separate mode for it. But I think the reason it doesn't exist in the base game really at all is because it is a co-op game. It's kind of like it's a three player, you've got a crew and you've got build crafting and you're going and you're fighting the enemy together. It also is a live service game with seasons passes and content, and they have their first year of content already mapped out. I actually played through quite a bit of season one during the end game preview I did last month, and so like they put a surprising amount of effort and planning into like how this game is going to survive and grow over time. And so I think they're set up on that front. It's really just a question of, is this game going to click? Are people going to get it?
Yeah. I mean, I'm glad it finally came out. Like I never want to like root against a game. I don't think it's really doing much for me, but like I'm For Honor was the same way, where like this game came along and it was like super, like totally doing its own thing. It had like a weird control scheme. And I was like, well, that seemed cool anyway. And then they kept adding new like fighting men to it. Like they would just periodically be like, great news, everybody, the musketeer is here or whatever. Like it'd be like some guy with like a new axe. And like that community apparently was like completely, like they just had a really good community around it. Like they were all, they were really good at onboarding people.
I think that's what they're hoping for here. I think they're hoping that like, hey, this game has a lot more depth and if you're willing to give it a shot, which I think is why they made the beta open and they let people play as much as they want. My guess would be that probably worked for some people. I mean, it certainly did on for me, right? Like I had played this game a lot before the open beta, but seeing it all together and getting my chance to just like play as much as I wanted of it actually kind of sold me on it and made me more excited to play it. And so it's really just a question of, can you get over the fact that it's not at all the game you probably think it is? Yeah. And that's a hard thing to overcome. But once you accept it for what it is, it is actually a lot of fun.
That's wild.
So yeah. Far, anyway, I haven't gotten to the end game. We'll see.
My final question, is there any devil fruit in this game? Like any Gamu Gamu fruits that we can pick up so we can start stretching like Luffy?
Yeah, there are fruits that you can get. You harvest them as a boat. And unfortunately, I think that's where the One Piece references maybe end.
Damn it!
Yeah, sorry.
Harvest, they're trying to do like the pop culture, like in, you know, they'll do One Piece, but it's gonna be Netflix One Piece. They'll do maybe Jack Sparrow or whatever. They'll do maybe they can put some pop. They can, you know, they got Godzilla and David Diver.
I don't know how they can do crossovers, because the crossover would have to be the ship, because no, you're not gonna buy a skin for your character that you only see for 5 minutes at a time in between the main content of the game. You know what I mean? Because the ship is essentially the star of the show, and it actually shows when you're making your character, because they only give you like 8 models to look for on your character, and you do not get to customize them. It's like, hey, do you want to be this shade of guy, this shade of girl? That's it, you're done. And then you get to buy clothes for your pirate so that you can look cool while you're walking around the NPC or the social areas. But it's really just not the focus of the game at all. Huh. So if they wanted to incorporate like One Piece, they would have to put, you know, his ship in the game. That would be probably how they would do the crossover.
Real quick, Brian, you've been playing Like a Dragon Infinite Wealth. I've tried to sell you. I've been trying to sell you on Yakuza games for years, and you one of them finally clicked. What happened?
Well, I think I played around like 30 hours of Yakuza 0. I liked it a lot. I think I got distracted. I'm going to say something controversial here. I don't think games should be that long. I think they should be shorter. I think these games are too long, and that's the problem. Let's get that out of the way. Infinite Wealth is awesome. It is just lovely. It is really, really fun. It's super endearing. I keep thinking of it as sort of like a big, like the way Travis described, kind of like a big budget Earth Defense Force. This kind of feels like a big budget or bigger budget No More Heroes for me. Like it's got that really like, we were talking about Suda51 earlier. Love that dude. Love his games. No More Heroes is like one of my favorite franchises, but it's always just been like really kind of like rough around the edges. You know, it's extremely low poly. It's glitchy. The cities are empty. And, but it's full of heart, right? It's got a ton of charm. It's got great characters. It's violent. It's goofy. It's got lovely storytelling, and then just tons of really silly mini games and mischief to get into. And I'm just really loving my time with this game. I want to say I'm like 20, 25 hours in so far. And I'm just really enjoying running around Hawaii and getting into trouble, leveling up my characters, grinding out and fighting guys. Like the combat has this like really awesome sort of like Paper Mario feel to it, where it's turn-based, but it's got just enough arcadiness to it where, you know, there's time button presses and like team attacks. And you can also just like, once you start leveling up, you can just take on like groups of grunts and just pretty much auto kill them. And that's really been fun to just sort of like watch my little meters go up, run around town, collect stuff, get into fights with like mini bosses and stuff. And there's just so much here. It's absurd. Like there are sub games in this game that would be whole games elsewhere. There's an entire Animal Crossing game that's just like, I got into it and was like, this is way too deep, and also a spot on parody of Animal Crossing. Like right down to like, you know, a new day starts and they just play this like really cheesy like acoustic guitar riff that's like, and you're like, all right, this bootleg ass Animal Crossing, great. it's just great, man. Like it's just, I love the characters in this game. I love the art style, the animation. Just, it's just a really good vibe.
I'm so happy. I'm so happy. I I don't know. I'm always sort of like, is this gonna, maybe this will click. I don't know. Are you finding yourself like confused at all? Like, are you picking up the story? Just kind of rolling with it? Like, what's, I know that it's, there's a lot of lore. There's a lot to kind of.
Because you didn't play the original Like a Dragon, right?
No. So I skipped that and I am vaguely aware of the Yakuza franchise and I played like a, you know, what is, I thought was a lot of Zero, but that's like a third of that game apparently. Mm-hmm. But that's about it. And I like read a Wikipedia on like some of the character backstories and stuff like that. Just like a quick explainer. I had some people tweeting at me being like, is this like, I've never played this franchise. Should I start here? And I was like, not even sure how to answer. Cause like, yes, like it's working for me. Maybe it'll work for you. It just immediately kind of clicked with me. And I don't know what it is because like, I dug the sort of like, you know, action beat 'em up River City Ransom on steroids approach of Zero and the older ones, but like this turn-based stuff is like really working for me because I think it's, like I said, it's just hands-on enough and just dynamic enough and just interesting enough that it's not like sitting around and waiting for things to happen. Like it moves quick and the battles are pretty chaotic and frenetic, and you have like a lot of like, even when it's not your turn, like one of your dudes will like, you know, just pop an elbow out and just hit a dude and somebody else will punch you in the mouth. And all the characters have these really goofy attacks. Like there's this taxi driver that just does nonsense. Like he'll just like pull out a bucket and throw it on you and then or
wash
a guy really well. And if he washes him super well, he gets hurt. And if he's like allergic to washing, like he gets really hurt. Like it's just dumb, man. Like I don't know. This is totally clicking for me right now. This feels like the exact, like it's, you know, it's been, I live in the Bay Area in California. It's been like rainy and a little chilly here and there. And it's like, instead I'm running around Hawaii and I'm buying, you know, weapons and snacks for my team. We're going out to team dinners, getting the gang all drunk and we're going out and fighting into the night. You know, everyone's in a good mood. Like, I love it. It's just like, I'm just having a really, really good time with this game. If you're looking for like a very laid back vibe RPG right now that also has a great story, a ton of side content. If you're looking for like a desert island game where you can actually swim, unlike that game that Travis just talked about, then I think this is it. Like, this is one of those games that like, if you gave this to me when I was like 14 and it was the only game I could play for the whole year because I didn't have any money, I would be enamored. Like I would just be playing this game nonstop because there's just so much here. I can't even imagine like getting the platinum trophy in this game. It probably takes like 200 hours. Like it just rules. I love this game. I'm so glad I'm playing it. And I will continue to enjoy this game and this franchise for years to come. I can tell. Yeah.
I am so happy to hear that. There have been a lot of stuff going on here at IGN. We are working on IGN FanFest 2024, which is kind of like our equivalent of like a virtual Comic-Con almost. It's super fun. We got a bunch of really cool like reveals and interviews and trailers and, you know, segments and featurettes and stuff lined up. And it all kicks off on February 19th. From the 19th to the 22nd, we've got sort of a bunch of stuff that's going to be rolling out on IGN. And then on February 23rd and 24th, we've got big old like live streams happening, basically like we do at, you know, Comic-Con or E3 or Gamescom or whatever like that. And also we just announced today that IGN Live is happening this summer, which is going to be a physical in-person event. We'll have more details on that soon to come. Thank you all for joining me, for hanging out, and thank you everybody who watched and listened at home. We'll see you next week from all of us here at Beyond.
Beyond.
Countdown initiated. Stand by for takeoff. Extraction complete. Silicon 1 begins.